denying the new covenant, you faithless. Because the new covenant, the blood of Hamashiach, our sins being covered, that's a part of the faith. I got faith that the Lord got me covered by his blood. Oh, no, the new covenant ain't going to be until when we get inside the kingdom. So you saying we ain't going to get the blood of Hamashiach over us until we get in the kingdom. Meaning you better hope that the blood is on your life. When it's evident out of everything, out of his grace in your life, you've been blessed to come into this truth and become purged, to become cleansed. To receive this word while you looking at others who are around you who are clueless and blind to this, man. He's chosen you who is wretched, who is a stinking, filthy rag. Come on, man. Most of us got a dark history, man, and can think back like we don't even deserve this. Do you see this?
And another thing too, right? Y'all saying that we're not going to be ushered into the new covenant, into the kingdom of heaven. That's y'all saying that y'all dead, man, because you can't be justified by the first covenant and you rejecting the second covenant. The Lord ain't dealing with you at all. Mm-hmm. Y'all dead men walking.
Where you think Isaiah 4:1 come from? Oh, where it say seven women shall take hold of one man. In that day shall seven women take hold of one man, and they'll tell him, be with them to take away their iniquity. How do they know that man could take away their iniquity?
Because they had the Holy Spirit.
Paul prophesied it in 1 Corinthians chapter 7. She's going to be sanctified through that man. Sanctified meaning cleansed. Of all her iniquity.
Basically, you gotta shoot the spirit inside of her. Mm-hmm. If you know what I mean.
And she's gonna come under the new covenant.
Right.
Because she's your wife. See, y'all, you are not knowing the scriptures.
Shalom. I want to start off by giving all praise, honor, and glory to Yahweh Bahashem, Yahweh Shai Bahashem, Rakah Kodesh. All blessings, honor, glory, and power be unto the Heavenly Father, whose name is Yahweh and His only begotten Son, our Lord and Savior, whose name is Yahweh Shai. And double honors to the apostles and the other bishops of Great Millstone who taught me His truth, and salutations to the elect scattered abroad throughout the four corners of the earth. All right, my name is Amon Gabar, and I'm back with another lesson, Lord willing, edifying straight to the point. And, Lord willing, this is edifying. This is pretty much, you know, laying back off of the videos I've been watching recently. The Elder Apostle Gabar had did a few videos concerning this topic. A few elder brothers had did videos concerning this topic about these guys that you've seen in the beginning of this video, pretty much saying that we're already in the new covenant, that the new covenant is already established and that we're in it and so on and so forth, which is not true. Okay, we're not in the new covenant. All right, we're under grace. Okay, we're under grace, and Yahweh Shah, Lord, I'm going to get all the scriptures, Abarazazal, Yahweh Shah already, you know, him dying on the cross, going up on the cross, was the beginning of the new covenant, so to speak, all right? Now, that was like the Lord signing, putting his signature on this new contract, all right? But we're waiting for the contract to fully take the effect, It's not in full effect yet, but the contract is written. Okay, it's already written. It's there. We just waiting to pretty much move into this new apartment. It's almost like you got a lease, right? You signed the lease agreement. You signed this. You signed the documents and all that. But then there's a moving date. We didn't move in yet. We didn't move into the kingdom yet. We didn't move into this new covenant yet. But the signature is already there. Yahweh already, you know, he took care of that. All right, so we're under the grace period. This is the moving out phase, so to speak, leaving one apartment, so to speak, you know, to move into the next one. All right, and the next one will be the final stage, no more moving after that, meaning no more, you know, sinning, going off, You know, breaking the law, statute, and commandments, which ultimately is the new covenant. So we're in transition, and that's the important thing about understanding grace, because this is the grace period. All right, and what you do, what are you going to do? What are you doing with the grace period? This is the grace period, because, you know, like I said, like brothers, apostles, elder brothers been saying this, we're not in the new covenant. If you know what the new covenant is, you know that we're not in it yet. All right, but we're transitioning into it. And Yahweh Shah is ultimately going to fulfill that when he come back and change our bodies. Now, one thing they said, which was totally weird and off, was that, I think, wait, what did he say? I put it up there, but he said that, he mentioned Isaiah 4:1, saying that we're going to take away their sins. We're going to take, Lord willing, we those men, we're going to take away their reproach. And when you get the word reproach, because the scriptures say, take away shame, right? Because what's iniquity? Sin upon sin. And Yahweh Shah, he got the power to forgive sins. All right? And it says that throughout the whole scriptures. I'm going to just jump around real quick just to get the point. This is on Matthew 9:6. I'm just straight to the point. But that ye may know that the Son of Man, this is in a red letter, hath power on earth to forgive sins. Okay? So Yahweh Shah got the power to forgive sins. It says that saith he to the sick and the palsy, arise, take up thy bed, go into thine house. Another one, Mark 2:10. But that they may know that the Son of Man have power on earth to forgive sins. He saith to the sick and of the palsy. Another one, Luke 5:24. But that ye may know that the Son of Man hath power on earth to forgive sins. He said unto the sick and palsy, I say unto thee, go arise and take up thy couch and go into thine house. And ultimately, Yahweh Shah got the power to forgive sins. And we all, Lord willing, we under that blood of the Lamb, you know, our sins are already covered. Our sins are forgiven. All right? Lord's will. We elect. All Israel will be forgiven, ultimately, in the new covenant, in the establishment of the law, statute, and commandments being written in our inward part, because that's the fulfillment of the new covenant. And I'm going to get them scriptures, too. So I bring that out because he says something by Isaiah 4:1. And then the dude said, 1 Corinthians 7, which don't make no sense, that, let me just go to it real quick. All right, 1 Corinthians 7. This just shows you that they don't understand what the new covenant is all about, or what it even means. Okay? So he said this, that the man would shoot his spirit inside of a woman to sanctify her, right? To make her whole, to make her holy, or whatever. And then she's under the new covenant. What are you talking about, bro? How does that even make sense? How does that even make sense? All right? Because once you're under the new covenant, ain't no turning back. That means you can't sin again. That means you can't go off again. But you can shoot your sperm up in a woman. If you're a man of the Lord, you shoot your sperm up in a woman, you pop her, you deal with her, she can still go off. She can still sin. Matter of fact, she can still go back into the world. Okay, she could be a Lot's wife. So that don't make any sense. You know, that don't make any sense. So that's not what that's talking about. And if that's the case, then how do you explain this one? It says, 1 Corinthians 7:13, a woman which hath a husband that believe not, if she be pleased to dwell, excuse me, let me read it again. And the woman which hath an husband that believe not, if he be pleased to dwell with her, let her not leave him. So they can't leave each other as long as he's pleased to dwell with her. They're one. They're attached. There's no breaking up, no splitting up, as long as he's pleased to dwell with. Okay? So verse 14 says, for the unbelieving husband is sanctified by the wife, and the unbelieving wife is sanctified by the husband. They said that the unbelieving wife is sanctified by the husband by him shooting his spirit inside of her, and then she's under the new covenant. But how the hell is the unbelieving husband sanctified by the wife? What is the wife shooting in the husband now? That don't make any damn sense. All right, that don't make any sense. You know, we already explained what this is talking about. For the unbelieving husband is sanctified by the wife, okay? And the unbelieving wife is sanctified by the husband, because you can have a woman. Brothers can have wives in this truth that don't believe, they're non-believers, or they're not in this truth per se, but they're dwelling with you, okay? They're pleased to dwell with you. They're working, and y'all doing accordingly, according to the Spirit. You know, she's serving you as her husband. You know, she's serving you as her being your wife. You're the husband, obedient. You know, she's according to you, whatever the case may be. Then you deal with her. All right? She'll be saved and sanctified through you. And it's the same thing with the women who have husbands that don't believe. He could be saved through you. He could believe because of you. All right? He could believe because of you, because of your faith. When SHTF and he start realizing that, yo, my wife was right about this whole thing. Just like that, you know, his faith can be converted. You know? So that this have nothing to do with what the hell he said about shooting your spirit or shooting your sperm inside of her. All right? And now when you go to Isaiah 4 and 1 in the blue letter, and you go down to, says, let us be called by thy name to take away our reproach. You look up the word reproach. Reproach simply means reproach, scorn, taunt, scorn, reproach, a reproach, or shame. It says condition, resting upon condition of shame or disgrace. And what makes women, compared to the ancient world, in this world, what makes women in this world shame and disgraceful? Among many things, it could be many, many, many things, but the main things is one, being single, and two, being unmarried, single or married, same thing, and being without child. How do you know that? You go to the book of Genesis real quick, the 30th chapter. Go to Genesis 30, and I'm going to start at verse 22. Because when you read about it, Jacob's two wives, you had Leah and Rachel. All right, Jacob favored Rachel, but he got Leah first, and then he had to work longer for Rachel. But Leah was the more fruitful one. She had the majority of our forefathers. All right, she had the majority of the sons and a daughter, Dinah. But Leah had the majority of the sons, and Rachel wasn't having seeds at the time. So let me just read this. The one Jacob favored the most didn't really wasn't having seeds at the time, so she felt some type of way about it. Like all women about to feel some type of way about their current condition, being without child, being single because of choice, because society told them that that's the way to go. But they're going to realize that that wasn't true, and the serpent bamboozled them. So they're going to want to take away that approach. They're going to want to go back to the old way. So let's read it. Genesis 30 and 22. And God, Yahweh Bashem Yashah, remember Rachel. And the Heavenly Father hearkened unto her and opened her womb. And she conceived and bare a son and said, the Most High take away my reproach. All right? The Most High take away my reproach. What was her reproach? That she wasn't having no seeds. All right? That she weren't having no children. Okay? It says, and she called his name Joseph and said unto the Lord, and said, the Lord shall add to me another son. All right? The Lord shall add to me another son. So, which Joseph means to add. Yahusap, to add. So, her reproach was that she wasn't having no children. All right? Because, again, you read about Leah. Leah had, how many, it says right here, Leah bare Jacob the sixth son. Okay? And then it was, they both had handmaids, two handmaids, one and one. And they both had, both handmaids had two sons each for them. All right, so that's just an example to show you what it means to take away your reproach. So if not having a child back then in the ancient world was reproachful for a woman, how much more was being up in age and being single? All right, or how much more being up in age and or just being just passed around in this society or in the world, that would have been considered a harlot. So all women from all walks of life, fashions, and all types of things are going to want their reproach taken away when that time come, when shit get real, you know, hectic out here and dire. So anyway, that's just to, you know, put that out there, bring that point across, you know, that you know, dude said that you hitting it, busting up in the woman and shit is going to sanctify them and make them under the new covenant. That don't make no sense. So they don't understand what the new covenant is. So anyway, now I'm going to get a few scriptures, Lord willing, just going into the old covenant / new covenant, the promise, and so on and so forth. So first, let me go to Exodus, the 19th chapter. Actually, let me go to Genesis first. All right. Genesis, the 17th chapter. In verse, I started one. And Abram was 90 years old. and 90 years old and 99. And the Lord Yahweh appeared to Abram and said unto him, I am the Almighty Power. Walk before me and be thou perfect. And I will make my covenant between me and thee, and will multiply thee exceedingly. So this is the Lord talking about that covenant with Abram. And Abram fell on his face, and God talked with him, saying, as for me, behold, my covenant is with thee, and thou shalt be a father of many nations. Neither shall thy name any more be called Abram, but thy name shall be called Abraham. For a father of many nations have I made thee. All right, Abba Raham, a father of many. Okay, a father of a multitude. It says, and I will make thee exceeding fruitful, and I will make nations unto thee, and kings shall come out of thee. And I will establish my covenant between me and thee and thy seed. All right, notice it says seed as in singular, after thee and their generations, for an everlasting covenant, to be a God unto thee and to thy seed after thee. Seed as in singular. Okay? So now we understand that the Lord said he was going to, we could read on, but we understand that the Lord said he was going to establish that covenant, all right, that established that covenant with Abraham and his seed after him, okay? And as you read on, the token of that covenant was the physical token was the circumcision, okay, to be circumcised, circumcising male children. So anyway, that was the promise that the Lord made with Abraham, okay, the father of the multitude. Now Galatians, we could go to Galatians, the third chapter, just to show you the seed, okay? Galatians, the third chapter, and verse, let me go to 14. This is Galatians 3 and 14. Matter of fact, I'll start at 13. It says, Yahusha had redeemed us from the curse of the law, being made a curse for us, for it is written, curses everyone that hangeth on the tree. And what is that talking about? Yahusha began put up on that cross, all right, dying for the sins of the nation of Israel. It's all throughout the scriptures, Matthew 1 and 21. Let's go to it real quick. All right, Matthew 1 and 21. I'm going to jump back to Galatians, the third chapter. Matthew 1 and 21, bit simple. It says, and she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Yahusha, for he shall save his people from their sins. Yahusha, he's the deliverer. All right? And he shall save his people from their sins. What is sin? First John chapter 3. Okay, in verse 4. It says, whosoever committeth sin transgresseth also the law, for sin is transgression of the law. Now the new covenant, it tells you, I'm gonna get them scriptures, but you know, just to put things in perspective, how are we under the new covenant if we still breaking the law? If we still breaking the law, statute, and commandment? Because the new covenant, the fulfillment of it is that we're not gonna sin again. That we will always be a people unto Yahweh Bashem Yahushah. And the reason why we go into captivity is because we break the law. It's because we break the law, statute, and commandments, and turn aside and backslide and all of that. But that's not gonna happen again, because the law, statute, and commandments are gonna be written in that inward part. All right, so Yahusha dying on the cross, he is like, his blood already established that. Okay, his blood was like the signature on this new agreement that we're about to enter into. All right, now we're in that transition period. The old covenant, we're here, and then you got the new covenant. All right, so we working our way through the spirit and power of Yahweh Bashem Yahusha to that promise, and that's why we cannot wait for all hell to break loose and for things to hit the fan, so we can actually be in a fulfillment of that covenant, that agreement. Okay, matter of fact, because I know I'm jumping around a lot, but when you go to Deuteronomy, the 28th chapter and verse 14 15, it says, I'm gonna jump to 15. It says, but it shall come to pass, if thou wilt not hearken unto the voice of the Lord thy power, to observe and to do all his commandments and his statutes, which I commanded thee this day, that all these curses shall come upon thee and overtake thee. We're still under the curses. We haven't been redeemed from all the curses yet. Jake is still getting sick, getting shot up, getting killed. You know, just all types of shit still happening in society concerning all the curses, all right, that's happening unto Israelites. But then when you read up to verse 1, it says, Deuteronomy 28:1, and it shall come to pass, if thou shalt hearken diligently unto the voice of the Lord thy power, to observe and to do all his commandments, which I commanded thee this day, that the Lord power, thy power, will set thee high, set thee on high above all nations of the earth. And all the blessings shall come unto thee and overtake thee. And if thou hearken unto the voice of the Lord the power, unto thy Lord thy power. So if we hearken unto the Lord our power, all right, all Israel, because this is all Israel is going to get it in the kingdom. This is a nation, a national thing. All right, this is pursuant to all Israelites. We're all under the curses. All right, and then when the blessings come, all Israelites are going to be under the blessings, starting with the elect. All right, those that are going to be delivered from out of this coming destruction. All right, now we know we're not going to get it right now. Let's go to what is it? Romans. It's in the book of Romans. The 9th chapter. Let me see. Let me see where I want to start at. Romans the 9th, it's in Romans the 9th chapter. And I'll start at the whole chapter is good. Let me just go to 9:11. It says, for the children being not yet born, neither having done any good or evil. All right, that the purpose of God according to election might stand, not of works, but of him that calleth. All right, not of works, but of him that calleth. Why? Because Yahweh Hashem Yahweh Shah, it's already preordained who the chosen was going to be. Matter of fact, when you read up above, it goes into what I was reading in Genesis, and it also ties into Galatians, the 3rd chapter, about the seed. So let me read up, actually. So Romans 9:6, not as though the word of God have taken none effect, for they are not all Israel which are of Israel. Neither because they are the seed of Abraham are they called all children, but in Isaac shall thy seed be called. Who came out of Isaac? Jacob. All right, Jacob, whose name was changed to Israel, came out of Isaac. Okay, so it says, that is, that they which are the children of the flesh, these are not the children of God, but the children of the promise are counted for the seed. Okay, counted for the seed, which the seed is Abraham, Isaac. Isaac is the seed, and then Jacob. For this is the word of the promise, at this time will I come, and Sarah shall have a son, Isaac. And not only this, but when Rebekah also conceived by one, even by a father, Isaac. Okay, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And there's another one. In Romans, I think it's the 8th chapter. Romans 8 and chapter 19. It says, for the earnest expectation of the creature waited for the manifestation of the sons of the power. For the creature was made subject to vanity, not willingly, but by the reason of him who has subjected the same in hope. All right, we're the creature. We were subject to vanity. The vanity is talking about sin. All right, we were created in these earthen vessels, which are corruptible. But the time of incorruption is coming. Like it tells us that in 1 Corinthians, the 15th chapter, that in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, we should be changed. The corruptible must put on incorruption. That didn't happen yet. All right, these bodies are still corruptible. These bodies are still subject to sin. These bodies are still subject to vanity. So we're still under that, under the chains of darkness. Okay, but this is the grace period, because Yahweh Hashem Yahweh Shah is forgiving sins. All right, the Heavenly Father through His only begotten Son is forgiving sins. Repentance is still open, but that time is coming to an end. All right, let me jump down. It says, verse 24, for we are saved by hope, but hope that is seen is not hope. For what a man seeth, why do he yet hope for? But if we hope for that which we see not, then do patience do we wait for it, which is talking about faith, all right? Faith. Romans 11 tells you that faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Okay, so we got to wait. We got to wait for the manifestation of the sons of God. You know, that we are changed and we come out of this corruptible bodies. Okay, so let me go to Exodus chapter 19. And I'll start at verse 3. And Moses went up unto God, unto the heavenly Father, Yahweh Shem Yahushua, and the Lord called unto him out of the mountain, saying, Thus shalt thou say to the house of Jacob, and to tell the children of Israel, Ye have seen what I have done unto the Egyptians, and how I bear you on eagle's wings, and brought you unto myself. Now therefore, if ye will obey my voice indeed, and keep my covenant, then ye shall be a peculiar treasure unto me above all the people of the earth, for all the earth is mine. And ye shall be unto me a kingdom of priests and holy nation. These are the words which thou shalt speak unto the children of Israel. Now, by default, we are the holy nation, all right? A nation of kings and priests. But we're not in that lot yet, okay? Because we still have the oppressor ruling over us, okay? But when the Lord put it in our spirits to obey his voice, law, statute, commandments, all Israel, all right, that's going to change. Okay, we're going to be fully under the new covenant. We're going to have these nations under our feet. All right, ruling in the kingdom. We're not ruling yet. All right, we're not ruling yet. We still got to teach Israel. The scriptures say that in the kingdom, we're going to have no need that one teach another. But we still out here teaching on the highways and byways. We still teaching right now about the new covenant. When the new covenant is fulfilled, we're not going to be sitting up here teaching about what's in the new covenant. You know, now let me just get the scriptures on it now. Jeremiah 31 and verse 30 or 31. It says, Behold, the days come, say the Lord, that I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah, which is talking about all of Israel. Not according to the old covenant that I made with their fathers in the day that I took them by the hand and bring them out of the land of Egypt, which I read that in Exodus 19. Which my covenant they break. They broke it. We broke it. All right. Although I was a husband unto them, saith the Lord. But this shall be the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, saith the Lord. I will put my law in their inward parts and write it in their hearts, and will be their God, their power, and they shall be my people. This scripture alone proves that we're not in the new covenant. We're not. All right. We're approaching that. Okay, but it's going to be fulfilled when Yahweh Shah come back and change our bodies. All right? Now I'm going to go to 1 Corinthians 15. 1 Corinthians chapter 15. And towards the end, around 40-something. Let me see. Actually, I'm going to jump straight to the point, 50. It says, Now this I say, brethren, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of the Most High. Neither doth corruption inherit incorruption. Flesh and blood. This is flesh and blood. This is corruption. Remember, the creature was subject to vanity, not willingly, but by the will of him that made him. Corruption. The scriptures also tell you that all have sinned and came short of the glory of Yahweh Bashem Yahweh Shah. So we're all in sinful flesh. Under the new covenant, we will not be sinning. Behold, I shew you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible. And we shall all be changed. We shall be changed. For this corruptible, meaning these bodies, these chains of darkness, pursuing the Jude, this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. Immortal meaning able to die, meaning death, or dead. Immortal meaning not dead, not able to die. So we're going to live forever. Because again, the wages of sin is death. That's the only way we could live forever. You know, you're talking about we under the new covenant. You could walk outside your home right now and something happened to you. You end up, you know, Most High take you back to the spirit world. You know, in the new covenant, we're not going to die. We're going to be immortal. There'll be no danger and death around us. It says, for when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the same. Death is swallowed up in victory. We didn't conquer death yet. Through Yahushua, the elect have already conquered death, but we're still playing this thing out in real time right here, right now on earth. All right? The victory and overcoming the beast, his system and the image, we got to go through all of that. All right? We got to go through all of that in order to receive incorruption. Nobody made it yet, man. You know, so to say that we already in the new covenant, that means you're saying you made it already. That means you're saying you made it already. You cannot sin. You can't go off. So these guys don't understand what it means to be under the new covenant. It says, O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. So, O death, O grave, where's your sting at? Okay, because at this point, the elect have conquered death, as Yahusha did, have conquered sin, as Yahusha did. So it says, but thank be to our power, Yahweh Hashem Yahusha, which give us the victory through our Lord Yahusha. So we got the victory through our Lord. And that's in Hebrews, the 8th chapter. Lord, when I'm going to get that, and that'll probably be about it. It says, verse 58, therefore, my beloved brethren, be steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, for as much as ye know that your labor is not in vain. So we working to this finish line, man. We got to keep on running this race. We got to keep on. We see the victory that our Lord have already done. Now we working our way to that, man. All right? We working to that prize, that victory. Having our bodies change, you know? Hey, man, that's a beautiful thing, because if you think about it, the only ones that are going to have their bodies changed on this side is going to be those that get delivered on this side. Because in the kingdom, all Israelites are going to come back. The ones that die are going to come back already changed. They're going to come back fresh. They're going to come out the womb brand spanking new. New bodies, new everything, just brand spanking new. But the elect on this side, the ones that are going to make it, are going to be the ones that are going to be able to shed off the old mortal bodies and actually transition and change whilst getting beamed up into them ships. So that's a whole story to tell in the kingdom. You know, how the body changed, how it felt, and just, you know, those things, man. So the elect got a whole lot of victory to look forward to, man. Through Yahusha. So let's go to Hebrews, the 8th chapter. Hebrews chapter 8. And the whole chapter, man, the whole Hebrews is all about Yahusha, man. The whole book is about Yahusha. You read the whole Hebrews, the 8th chapter. Let me read, let me jump to, I forgot, I'm going to just start at verse 1. Start at verse 1. Hebrews chapter 8, verse 1. Now of the things which we have spoken, this is the sum. We have such an high priest who is set on the right hand of the throne of the majesty in heavens. Who's that talking about? Let's go to Psalms. Like it. This is Psalms 110 and verse 1. A psalm of David. The Lord said unto my Lord, sit thou at my right hand until I make thine enemies thy footstool. Alright, again. A psalm of David. The Lord said unto my Lord, sit thou at my right hand until I make thine enemies thy footstool. So our Lord is sitting at the right hand of the Father right now, at the right hand of his majesty. So, Revelation, the 5th chapter, you know, he took the little book that was at the right hand of the throne of the Heavenly Father. You know, so that's Yahusha, man, sitting at the right hand at the throne of his majesty. So Hebrews again. Hebrews the 8th chapter. In verse 1. My phone is acting up right now. Salakia, bear with me. It's acting all. I'm going to have to restart it. But Hebrews 8 and 1. Now of the things which we have spoken, this is the sum. We have such an high priest who is set at the right hand of the throne of the majesty in the heavens, Yahushua, a minister of the sanctuary and of the true tabernacle, which the Lord pitched and not of men. For every high priest is ordained to offer gifts and sacrifices. Wherefore, it is of necessity that this man have somewhat also to offer, which is what did the Lord offer up himself. For if he were on earth, he should not be a priest, seeing that there are priests that are offer gifts according to the law, who serve unto an example and shadow of heavenly things, as it is in heaven, so it will be on earth. All right. That will be done on earth as it is in heaven. It says, as Moses, which we what we have on earth and what's being established on earth is pretty much a blueprint on what's going to take place or what's taking place in the heavens. So what's happening in the heavens is going to be established on earth. All right. They don't go off. The angels don't sin in heaven. There's nobody going off in heaven. All right. In the heavenly realm. So when the things are established, when the new covenant is established, ain't going to be no sinning amongst Israelites on this earth. The only ones that are going to sin, that are going to have the stony hearts in the kingdom to come, are going to be the other nations. All right. Which they're going to be forced to keep our laws. Matter of fact, they're going to want to keep our laws. All right. When they realize how fruitful and how blessed our laws are to begin with. So verse 5 says, who serve unto the example of a shadow of heavenly things. And Moses was admonished of God, Yahweh Bashem, Yahweh Shah, when he was about to make the tabernacle. For see, saith he, that thou make all things according to the pattern shewed to thee in the mountain. What was the pattern? The pattern was the things that are heavenly. It says, but now hath he obtained a more excellent ministry. By how much also is he a mediator, a middleman, of a better covenant, which was established upon better promises. Okay, the better covenant, the better promises. Now we can read about the promise. Matter of fact, the promise, it tells you that, is it going to say it here? No. I just thought of a priest. So hold on 1 second. It's in Hebrews. I believe it's in Hebrews. No, Galatians. I'm sorry. Which I ain't even finished Galatians. I should have finished it. Galatians, the 3rd chapter. Let me go to it now. About the seed. And the point is in 17. But let me finish it up, then I'm going to go back to Hebrews 8. I'm a little all over the place. Lord's will, you know, it's edifying and everybody's following. So let me go to Galatians 3 and 13. It says, Yahweh shall have redeemed us from the curse of the law, being made a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is every man that hangeth on a tree, that the blessings of Abraham might come on the Gentiles through Yahweh shall. The Gentiles ain't talking about the heathens. The Gentiles are those that were once Gentiles, which are the Israelite foreigners, all right? Those that have fallen away from the law, statute, and commandments and the commonwealth of Israel and just they lost their identity, all right? The Lord is not a man that he shall lie. He's not a man that just changes and he would not give his glory unto another, like he said. You know, that's why the nations are ultimately mad, because Israelites, us, we're waking back up and we're reclaiming our identity as who we are as a nation, and we're saying that we are the children of the Heavenly Father. Okay, so that's the Gentiles coming back. And the nations are mad because they thought that they were the Gentiles who was going to get deliverance, but they're not. So anyway, that the it says Gentiles through Yahusha. Let me read it again. That the blessings of Abraham might come on the Gentiles through Yahusha, that we might receive the promise of the Spirit through faith. Now, if this was talking about the natural Gentiles, the heathens, then that would make the Heavenly Father lie. That means he broke his promise. If he promised unto Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, unto Abraham's seed, as in one, not many, but then he include the whole entire nation. What was the promise for to begin with? Why even make a promise? You know, if everybody was going to be included. So anyway, it says, brethren, I speak after the manner of men. Though it be but a man's covenant, yet if it be confirmed, no man disannulleth or addeth thereto. So that agreement, that promise, that covenant, it cannot be added or taken away. Now to Abraham and his seed, all right, seed as in singular, right? It says, where the promise made. He saith not, and to seeds as of many, not seeds as of many, but as of one. And to thy seed, which is Yahweh Shah, because Yahweh Shah came through the lineage of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Matthew, the first chapter, gives the genealogy and the generations of Yahweh Shah. It says, and this I say, that the covenant, and that the whole genealogy was all through the promise, through that line, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, all right, the chosen seed. And this I say, that the covenant that was confirmed before of God in Yahweh Shah, of Yahweh Bashem Yahweh Shah, the law which was 430 years after Abraham, right, the promise, and then the law, which is 430 years after, cannot put in no effect. That which is to make the promise of none effect. So the law don't just diminish the promise. Okay? For if the inheritance be of the law, it is no more of the promise. But God, the Most High, gave it to Abraham by promise. Wherefore then served the law? It was added because of transgression, till the seed should come to whom the promise was made, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And we're entering into that promise. And it was ordained by the angels in the hands of the mediator, or hands of a mediator. Now, a mediator is not a mediator of one, but God is one. Now, let's go back to Hebrews 8. The mediator, the middleman. Okay, because that's what mediator means. It means to be in the middle. So, verse 7, Hebrews 8 and 7. For if that first covenant had been faultless, then should no place have been sought for the second. And we understand that the creature was subject to vanity. Not willingly, but by the will of him that made him. And we're the creatures, and we would be subject to vanity, because this is the Lord's will, this is his program, this is how he wanted it done. It says, for finding fault with them, he said, behold, the days come, saith the Lord. And this was said in Jeremiah 31 and 31. So for finding fault with them, it's also in Ezekiel. Let me get that one too. Before, and I'm gonna jump back to Hebrews. Ezekiel chapter 36 and verse, I can start at verse 22. Therefore say unto the house of Israel, thus saith the Lord Yahweh, I do not this for your sakes, O Israel, O house of Israel, but for mine holy name's sake, my holy name's sake, which ye have profaned, among the heathen, whither ye went. And I will sanctify my great name, which was profaned among the heathen. And the Lord is doing that now. It's starting now. All right? He's sanctifying, making holy his great name. So we got to know the name. Okay, guys are still profaning and just trampling underfoot the true names, Yahweh Bah, Shem Yahweh Shah. You know, for one, not calling, you are Israel, here is you are Israelite, but you're not calling on your true power. Now, that's going off. Okay, once you come back into this truth, this fold, you know you're Israelite, you know the truth, now you got to dig deep. All right, you got to call upon those names and establish that relationship, so-called relationship, so to speak, between you and Yahweh Shah, man. You can't do that through any other name, no Christ, no Most High, no nothing, no titles, but through them names, all right? So the Lord is doing this for his name's sake. So he is doing what? He is sanctifying his great name, which was profaned among the heathen, which ye have profaned in the midst of them. And the heathen shall know that I am the Lord, saith the Lord Yahweh, when I shall be sanctified in you before their eyes. For I will take you from among the heathen. And it's all starting now. This is a rehearsal. That's another precept. Judges 5 and 11. In the places of drawn water. All right. And there shall they rehearse the righteous acts of the Heavenly Father. All right. Which is talking about here. In our captivity. We rehearsing the righteous acts. The righteous acts are the law, statute, and commandments. If we had the second covenant already in us, then there would be no need for a rehearsal. The second covenant is the done deal. It's the final deal. All right? This is still a rehearsal. You know? And during any rehearsal is a grace period. Because once the actual showdown, ain't no time for mistakes. There's no room for error. So the Lord is going to correct it. And ain't going to be no room for error. Ain't going to be no error during the second covenant. during the establishment of the second covenant. In the kingdom, we ain't going to go off. We ain't going to be, oh, I made a mistake. Ain't going to be no such word as a mistake for the Israelites in the kingdom. Nope. Not at all. So verse 24 says, for I would take you from among the heathen and gather you from out of all the countries and will bring you into your land. That's, this is going to happen soon. This is when Yahweh shall come back to redeem his elect. Then will I sprinkle clean water upon you, and ye shall be clean from all your filthiness, and from all your idols will I cleanse you. Okay, a new heart. This is us being clean, purified. Okay, a new heart, meaning a new mind also will I give you, and a new spirit will I put within you. And I will take away the stony heart out of your flesh, and will give you a heart of flesh. And I will put my spirit within you, and cause you to walk in my statutes. So the Most High is going to make us walk in his statutes. All right, this is the new covenant. Jeremiah 31, Hebrews 8, Ezekiel 36 chapter is all talking about the law, statutes, and commandments being written in our inward part. Okay, the Heavenly Father is going to cause us to walk in his statutes, his commandments. And ye shall keep my judgments and do them. And ye shall dwell in the land that I gave to your fathers. Another thing, if we was under the new covenant, we would have been in our land. We're not in our land. All right, we're far from it. Deuteronomy 28, no man shall buy you. The Lord ain't redeem us yet. We're in the process of redemption. All right, that's why the elect are being tried. The elect are being purified like gold. Because when it's time for the Lord to swoop up his elect, they're going to be pure gold. You know, Abiratazah, I pray I'm part of that number. You know, be pure gold, tried and refined and pass through that fire, ready to be set up in this kingdom to come. All right, ultimately getting our bodies changed. And all, you know, all that's going to be redeemed, every Israelite that's going to be delivered from this coming destruction is going to have their bodies changed. Ain't going to be no foul, no vile thoughts and wicked, you know, no flesh. You know, I read it, 1 Corinthians 15. No bug outs in the king, in the chariots, you know, no thinking, no weird thoughts, and no sinning, no going off. Everything is going to be perfect, man. So to say that we're under the second covenant already is just off. Okay, so verse 28 says, and ye shall dwell in the land that I gave to your fathers, and ye shall be my people, and I'll be your power. I will also save you from all your uncleanness, and will call you, and will call for the corn, and will increase it, and will lay no famine upon you. And I'll multiply the fruit of the tree, and the increase of the field, and, excuse me, that ye shall receive no more reproach of famine among the heathen. And that's another thing, great famine is coming, and this is going to be the ultimate famine. The Lord have always sent famine as a reproach for our sins and our trespasses and going off. But this is going to be the ultimate one. That's why we know this is going to be the bad one. And the Lord is going to have to himself send his angels to deliver his elect from what's about to come. So we know this is going to be the final showdown on what's to come. And after this, it's going to be no more. It's going to be no more. All right. To say that the second being the second covenant and that we, you know, it just don't make no sense when you read the scriptures. Then shall you remember your own evil ways and your doings that were not good, and shall loathe yourselves in your own sight for your iniquities and for your abominations. And for a period of time, Israel that's going to come back, they're going to feel messed up over themselves for what they've done and for what the Lord had done for us, you know, Lord willing. And for a period of time, they're going to loathe and feel bad. But then after that, you know, the glory. So I'll go back to Hebrews 8 and I believe I'm going to end it. I did take down a couple notes, but I think I covered pretty much what I wanted to through the Spirit. I hope so, you know, Abiratazah. So anyway, Hebrews 8 and 8. For finding fault with them, he saith, behold, the days come, save the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah, not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers in the day when I took them by the hand and led them out of the land of Egypt, because they continue not in my covenant, and I regarded them not, save the Lord. For this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, save the Lord. I will put my law, statute, and commandments in their mind and write them in their hearts, and will be to them a God, a power, and they shall be and they shall be to me a people. And they shall teach, they shall not teach every man his neighbor. Why? Because we're not going to need to. There ain't going to be no camps. There ain't going to be no GMS Awakening 144 in the kingdom, you know, no Remnant Save in the South Carolina, declaring GMS, declaring the end, the Apostle Ron Lobb, Info Doc. No, it ain't gonna be that, because we're not gonna need to do that, man. You know, we're not gonna need to do that. We're doing it now. Through the Spirit and power of Yahweh Bashem Yahshua, it's happening now. All right? We're teaching now. You know, Israel's learning their old ways again, turning back to the old ways, the righteous way, or rehearsing the righteous act. This is the rehearsal. This is the grace period. We're not in the second covenant. Okay? This is the period in between leaving one, approaching the next. All right? We're still en route. You know what I'm saying? And Lord willing, this the road. We're almost at the end of the road of Babylon, man. You know? Lord willing. This is the end of the road for Babylon and then the beginning of the kingdom to come. Esau is the end of the world and Jacob is the beginning of it that followeth. So, a couple more scriptures and I'm out of here, Lord willing. So, and they shall not teach every man his neighbor and every man his brother, saying, know the Lord, for all shall know me, from the least to the greatest. So every Israelite is going to know the true powers, Yahweh, Bashem, Yahusha. Babies are going to be born in knowing the Lord. Babies going to be born righteous. You ain't have to teach a child up, raise a child in the way that he going to go. Because they're going to be born righteous. The law, statute, and commandments going to be in the inward part. They ain't going to sin. They ain't going to go off. They ain't going to be rebellious. They ain't going to be none of that. It says, for I will be merciful to the unrighteous, and their sins and their iniquities I will remember no more. In that, he saith, a new covenant he hath made the first old, now that which decayeth and waxing old is ready to vanish. You know, hey man, all praise to Yahweh Bashem Yahusha. Even Galatians talk about the schoolmaster, the Lord being a schoolmaster and all that. You know, but you know, we definitely approaching these times, and that's why we can't wait to get the hell up out of here. So we ain't have to be doing, you know, sit downs and lessons on are we in a new testament or new covenant or not. No, the time is going to be, it's going to be made known. It's not going to be a debate. We're not going to have to be going, you know, debating each other. We're not in the new covenant. We're not in the old covenant, whatever, you know, because the Lord is going to make it to where nobody's going to have to teach nobody. All Israel's going to have it. We're going to be righteous. So we definitely not in the new covenant, man. All right. And we're under grace. Okay. What is a matter of fact, I'm going to type in what is a grace period. And I'll end it on that. What is a grace period? A grace period is a period immediately after the deadline for an obligation during which a late fee or other actions that would have been taken as a result of failing to meet the deadline is waived, provided that the obligation is satisfied during the grace period. And what's the grace period about? Getting right. Because that's another thing. If we were 100% under the old covenant, the law, statute, commands, we'd all be dead. Okay? We'd all be dead. So we're in that grace period where we getting ourselves right, you know, in the sight of Yahweh Bashem Yahusha, repenting. Okay? Repenting. Psalms 51 says the Lord don't require sacrifice for sin anymore, but sacrifice for sin, let me just get it real quick. All right? Psalms 51. Because part of the law, it is part of the law to sacrifice, but Yahweh Shah being the ultimate sacrifice. You know, we don't have to offer up bullocks and sheep, goat, and those type of sacrifices anymore. This is Psalms 51 and 16. For thou desirest not sacrifice. The Lord don't desire to sacrifice as he did. All right, the old sacrifice. Else would I give it. Thou delightest not in burnt offerings. The sacrifice of Yahweh Bashem Yahusha, a broken spirit, a broken and a contrite heart. O God, thou would not despise. All right. Now, contrite, a feeling or expression of remorse, penitence, to repent. Okay, so to repent is the sacrifices of sin right now. You know, because we know that we're not in our glorious bodies yet. We're in this, these bodies are cursed. Okay, I curse this damn body. Fuck these bodies, bro. You know, our bodies ain't shit. They're cursed. We're cursed. As long as we in these bodies, we'll always be under the curses. You know, until Yahweh Shah change our bodies, then we will be under the blessings. So we're not under the new covenant, man. All right? We're within that grace period as of now until the Lord comes and change it all. Okay? So that's it. I mean, I guess I end it here. You know, I end it here. I pray and hope to Yahweh Bashem Yahusha that this was an edifying lesson to the elect of the nation of Israel. Till next time, Shalom.